I was adamant about finding something where I just play a guy with a human guy with a problem, you know, just who encounters obstacles and just has a healthy fear of death, you know, because Ghost Rider doesn't have any of that. Terminator definitely doesn't have any of that. So I just wanted to play a man with a family who just has human problems. And so my team over at Management 360, my management company, they were handling that, and they sent me the script, and I read it, and I liked it, and they offered me the role, and I was happy to take it, because at the time we were in the middle. Well, actually, no, I accepted it in November of 2019. And they were working pre-production. We were about to go in March. And then, of course, the world stopped. And Italy at that time was the producers were Italian. We were going to shoot in Rome. And originally Belize was the other location. But at the time, Italy was the hot spot. Like, that was the COVID epicenter of COVID. And so we were like, okay, we're not going to Italy to shoot right now. We got to push it, and we got to figure out what's going to happen with the world. And as time progressed, Los Angeles became the epicenter of COVID, and Italy didn't want us over there. Like, why would we want to bring you guys in here? You guys are worse than us at this point. And so, but we finally figured it out. I got my work visa. We did a month and a half shoot in Rome, and then we did another month shoot in Guatemala. It was eventually where we landed for the other location. And so, yeah, I just got a cut of the film. I think they're still finalizing some stuff. We've held it for a long time just because most festivals were virtual, and I think they wanted to have a full experience with the film and get it to buyers in a way that makes it the most appealing. But it's a great, great story. Joanna Vanderham, wonderful Scottish actress, played my wife in the film, and she's, of course, in Warrior, and I think she's actually doing a show right now with my good friend Ian, another beautiful Scot that I love, Ian, who played Fitz, of course, Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. But don't really have a timeline on that film, but it is close to my heart. It's a really beautiful story about family, and I hope people get to see it once it comes out.
So I'm curious how you ground yourself and your character when you're dealing with big set pieces and big action pieces or working with a green screen.
Yeah, right. No, I just revert to my stage training experience, I think. You know, because when you're on stage and the lights are as bright as they are and you're staring out into this black void, you just, you have to build the world. You have to see the landscape, see the environments, and stretch your imagination in that way. And that's exactly what you do when you're playing the tennis balls and screens. Obviously I don't have no focus. I just get distracted. No, it's but the to maintain the physical energy and the vibration you need in those moments when you don't have the stimulus is a technique in and of itself. And I think that, like I said, I just revert to those days I spent on the stage, I think helps a lot.
You've now basically been part of two of the biggest franchises in the world, in MCU and Terminator. Uh-huh. How does that feel for you personally, and is there another franchise you want to be part of?
Yeah, the Ghost Rider Marvel world is just so massive and so beloved, and we've handled it in such a really fine way that world is just continually ran parallel with our own, and so it feels real, you know, it feels like it's happening in real time. The Terminator is something I grew up loving and have always loved and know that mythology so well, and was so proud to be part of Jim's telling of that next true chapter of it. I know The Last of Us is going to be something that I think falls into that, because now the gaming industry really dwarfs our industry. I think it's tenfold in terms of its revenue generated through gaming, as opposed to film and television. And I see it here, you know, I'm sitting and we're signing and doing all these things, and you see these really wonderful voice actors who are part of these game franchises that have this beloved, you know, they're just beloved by their fan base. So I'm excited for that, for The Last of Us to be included in that. And I've been so happy and privileged to be able to contribute to those worlds, because, you know, I made it a point to just be patient and say no to the things that you know aren't right for you and that don't depict me in a way that, you know, just quite simply my grandma wouldn't be proud of. And say, you know, prepare yourself to establish yourself as a hero, someone to be looked up to, someone to be admired by not only people that look like you, but people, more importantly, people who don't look like you. Because I think that's the true goal of representation. Is sure, I want people to see themselves on screen, but what's important is for people to see themselves in someone who doesn't look like them on screen. So that's really kind of the true intent. And I think to answer the second part of your question, I think that's very clear. Only thing that's left is Star Wars. and I've made it very clear to Dave and Carrie and everyone over there what my aspirations are. And I also in the panel, I just said I wrote a whole full, like, 2-page letter to Dave and Carrie about my my deep love for Ezra Bridger from Star Wars Rebels. Mm-hmm. And that's not saying anything's happening with that character. That's not at all what, you know, as far as I know, but I definitely wanted to be have a preemptive strike when it comes to my hat in the ring for that. So I just wrote him a letter telling how much I loved it. My last name's Luna, so the two moons of Lothal and his attachment to animals, which I really have a lot of kind of similar vibrations with him. So yeah, Star Wars is all that's left, man. And I'm set. I'll be here for the rest of my life with these things, which is fun, which is happy for me, because I love this stuff. It's my chance to come and celebrate it too. So. Still a lot of progress to be made, but what I've been hoped to do is to deliver excellence when given the opportunity, which is a quote from Robert Rodriguez's Rebel Without a Crew. And it's use whatever resources you have when ever given the opportunity to deliver excellence, and just don't ever stop. That's literally the last line of his book. And you know, the hope is that when I get there, I work my tail off, man, and I do the job like a ditch digger, because, you know, I grew up from a family. My grandma worked at a laundromat. Grandpa laid tile. My mama is a 15-year-old widow, and she's been working for the state of Texas since she was old enough to work. So I bring that work ethic to the work in hopes that I nail it, that people are proud of it, the producers are happy, everybody's happy, director's happy. And then as a result, the door stays open for everyone to come up behind it. And, you know, what Antonio Banderas did and Alfred Molina, and going even further back, you know, Cesar Romero and all these people, Rudolph Valentino, all the way back, you know, it just takes somebody to keep kind of passing the baton and keep it going. And the way it's going to work is you got to just show that people love to see it. People love to have people, you know, actors come in and do the job. And yeah, the idea is just do a solid job so the door stays open behind you. And so I'm thankful to all those who came before me. And then hopefully I've contributed to that and widened the passage for even more, and which seems to be the case. Yeah. You know, I think a lot of what I get when people give me praise on the work is that there's a soul to it. And for me, I think it goes back to when I was first starting and you know, I lost my football scholarships, and I ended up being an actor through a crazy twist of fate, and I saw this video of my father who was wrote and starred and directed this play for church before I was born. You know, he passed shortly after that, and 3 months prior to my birth, and I just think that and then when I got there to my very first audition, it was my senior year of high school, and they gave me sides that were the first scene of the play where the main character is talking to this older woman standing in front of two unmarked graves asking which one belongs to his father. And I remember thinking, I've done this before, I know what this feels like. And so the audition was like breathing. It ended up being very easy. And I think that it's important for me to live a full life so that when I get there, I don't have to fake it. You know what I mean? It's not that I can have the experience of the Terminator or have the experience of being this immortal ghostwriter, whatever it is. It's just there are parts of Robbie that I understood. I understood the somewhat orphan quality to him. I understood him having to be paternal at a very young age. I understood his intelligence and his wit and his strength and all these things are important. And I love the way he was depicted, and mostly his soul. And so I think that that's hopefully what reads is the focus, the dedication, and how tight and how strongly it's tethered to my soul. You know, I when I'm there, I'm all the way there, and I hope that that's what people see.
Ghost Rider's got this, he's immortal, he said this kind of rich history of many riders. If you could explore another rider, be it past or in the future, another time period, which one would you like to explore and how would you like to do it, long form or kind of short form?
I like the, when Jason Aaron did that new Avengers run where Robbie becomes an Avenger, it starts in like a million BC and you got the rider on the woolly mammoth, so that would be kind of cool. And but also later in the run, they're down in hell, and you see all the riders down there because Johnny Blaze has been absorbing all the powers of all the Ghost Riders so that he can be the ultimate king of hell and actually keep a lid on it, you know. And you see all of these different, you know, there's like a 1930s detective rider, and then there's like this little, like his little sidekick. There's this guy who's riding in like a motorcycle with a sidecar, and there's like this little rider with like a, you know, like a little hat and a little baseball bat, and just, you know, there's all these different versions. There's like a Native American writer who's about to be introduced in another book, and which is interesting because one of the Native American national anthems is Ghost Riders in the Sky, I often played that on various different sets. I keep my guitar with me. Robert Rodriguez once gave to me a guitar, and I take it everywhere I go. I play that song quite a bit. So there's a lot of options to choose from. So I might as well just go for the very first one, who wrote a woolly mammoth.